Good afternoon to all of you. So this is a part of my series what we have started, where we'll be discussing some clinical scenarios and accordingly discussing the various the stuff related to that, which is academic, and it will be of immense importance for everyone, what we learn from those cases. So I welcome Dr. Prabhat Nandia, who is a cornea consultant at Suraj Eye Institute, Nagpur. And Dr. Bhaskar Srinivasan sir, who will be mentoring and moderating this meeting. He is a very senior consultant at Shankar Nethralaya Chennai. And I think Bhaskar sir, most of us are all aware about his accomplishments, and he's an excellent clinician for excellence. And I would like to ask Prabhat to continue with his presentation.
Thank you, Dr. Sarang. At the outset, I'd like to thank Dr. Bhaskar sir, or Dr. BSN as we refer to him at Shankar Nethralaya Chennai. He is my mentor and from my fellowship days. I would also take this opportunity to welcome Dr. Rama Rajgopal. She is the head of cornea services at Shankar Nethralaya Chennai. Without further ado, I would like to begin my presentation on corneal topography, back to basics. So what is corneal topography? It's the science of describing or representing the features of a particular place in detail. This is extremely important in the cornea, since its anterior surface is the major refractive surface of the eye. So the concept of corneal topography is not new. It came about 400 years ago. Scheiner introduced the concept when he held up glass spheres of different shapes and sizes close to a patient's cornea. He projected the same object onto both the cornea and the glass sphere, and the images were formed by both of these. And the glass sphere whose image resembled most closely the patient's cornea in terms of size and shape was considered to be similar to the cornea in size and shape, and that was the rough keratometric value. This was improved upon by Quignet in 1820s when he used a keratoscope with an illuminated light source. But the problem was that he did not account for how to view the changes on the corneal surface. So Placido in 1882, when he introduced the famous Placido ring, which has formed the base of all keratometry and all keratoscopy that we do today, what he did was place an observation ring of the center of his target. So he could, through the observation ring, look at the patient's eye and the image that was formed by his ring on the patient's eye. However, all of these values were not having any actual value. There were no numbers that were assigned. There was no keratometric value until von Helmholtz came out with the basic von Helmholtz keratometer for quantification. Still, we did not have any actual photographic documentation of the keratometry until Gulstrand introduced the concept of photocapture or photokeratoscopy. Now, what are the indications in clinical practice and research for topography? So in a normal cornea for screening, then contact lens fitting. For a normal cornea, you can just use your regular keratometry to advise for contact lens fitting. But if you're looking at irregular cornea such as keratoconus, dry eye, so on and so forth, you would probably want to do a corneal topography first and then advise the contact lens trial. Then for corneal diseases, again such as keratoconus and other diseases, for diagnosis and follow-up. In cataract surgeries, in simple cases, you can use a keratometry, a manual keratometer, for IOL calculation. However, if you're planning for a cataract surgery for a post-refractive surgery or a post-LASIK eye, you would probably want to do a corneal topography to get a better keratometric value. Again, in corneal graft surgeries, the major purpose that I have found is to follow up the terms of astigmatism, because this is a major contributing factor towards vision loss in these patients, and it helps in topography-guided suture removal and to improve the quality of vision, and also for contact lens fitting. Again, refractive surgery for image preoperative screening, and then for each visit follow-up to understand the changes that are occurring in the cornea because of the healing response. So the types of topography systems that are available, the first is what is known as a projection-based system. So if you look at this grid, also known as a raster, once it was projected onto a flat screen, you get a flat image. If it's projected onto the cornea, you get a curved image, as you can see here. Now, this curved image can be compared to this flat image, and the elevation of each point above the corneal surface can thus be compared and obtained. So this gives us direct elevation or direct height data. In comparison, the reflection-based systems use what is known as the Purkinje image. That is the image formed by the cornea on the anterior surface of the lens, which is a virtual image, and the placebo-based rings are then projected onto the cornea, and the rings that are observed on the cornea, they give us what is known as the slope or angulation of each point on the cornea. And once this is obtained, from that we can calculate the curvature or the radius of curvature of each point, and then using mathematical formulae we can calculate the power. So projection based systems are not commonly used in clinical practice. Reflection based systems are more commonly used and include placebo ring, keratometer and video keratoscopes. If you look at this particular ring image that I have been showing, you can see that these rings appear fairly normal but are slightly close together inferiorly than superiorly. This was a patient with early keratoconus. In comparison, if you look at these rings from another patient, these rings are squished together inferiorly and separated out superiorly. This was a patient with advanced post-LASIK ectasia. Again, coming back to the projection and reflection based systems, as I've already discussed, the projection based systems give us directly the height or the elevation data from which you can calculate the angulation or the slope. The reflection based systems give us the slope directly, but you cannot calculate directly the height. There are certain assumptions that are involved. So the height or elevation data that you get from a reflection based system is not very reliable. From the height and from the slope, using multiple mathematical calculations, you can calculate what is known as the radius of curvature at each point on the cornea. The radius of curvature can be of two types: the global or axial radius of curvature and the local or the tangential radius of curvature. I will be covering these in detail in subsequent slides, but for now we need to remember that there are two types: the axial and the tangential radius of curvature. Again, using the radius of curvature, power calculations can be done, which I will get to in the next slide. So let us say that this is a point X on the cornea, and what is done is this is the optical axis of that particular eye. So this is a slope or a tangent that has been dropped down to the optical axis. This angle alpha is what is known as the slope, which is obtained from the reflection based systems. By the concept of similar triangles, this angle alpha is the same as this angle alpha, and by using trigonometry we can see that the radius of curvature will be distance d divided by cos of alpha. So this radius of curvature is basically when a perpendicular line to the tangent that crosses that particular point for whose radius of curvature we are calculating, and then this radius of curvature line is dropped down to the optical axis. So this radius of curvature is from that point and in relation to the optical axis. All radius of curvature that are calculated in terms from the cornea in terms of the optical axis are known as global or axial radius of curvature. Again, from the radius of curvature, using the refractive index and the standard keratometry index, N2 is an assumption of 1.3375 for the refractive index of cornea. N1 is the refractive index of air, that is 1. So therefore, P or the keratometric power in diopters is 0.3375 divided by the radius of curvature in meters. Now, moving on to the various types of reflection-based systems that are available, the Placido disc is a set of concentric rings with a black on white background that was introduced by Placido in 1882. It is reflected from the anterior cornea. It gives us qualitative assessment in terms of how the Myers are distorted, but there was no quantification. The quantification was first introduced by Wald Helmholtz in form of the keratometer. The improved version of this is the current Poisson-Lohm keratometer, commonly used in clinical practice. And what this does is, this is a central 3 mm circle or annulus, and it calculates 4 points across that, and those 4 points keratometric value alone is provided. So while this is a fairly reproducible and accurate measure for normal corneas and regular spherocylindrical surfaces, it can be used for normal contact lens fitting, can be used for normal IOL power calculation. It cannot be used very well in irregular corneas, because within the 3 mm circle or outside the 3 mm circle, it does not give us any further information. So from the keratometer, we move to the photokeratoscope and then to the computerized video keratoscopes, which are commonly available in clinical practice today. If you look at the number of points that are covered, it's only 4 in a keratometer versus up to 11,000 points in a computerized video keratoscope. And the area covered again is only the 4 points of the 3 mm circle versus 95% of the corneal surface, almost limbus to limbus. Again, the dioptric range has improved to up to 110 diopters of coverage and up to 38 rings, and good accuracy and sensitivity of plus minus 0.25 diopters and good reproducibility. This is the difference of the rings that we see across the multiple generations of reflection-based systems, with the keratometers containing a single ring, more so in the photokeratoscope, and multiple up to 38 rings in the video keratoscope. What is video keratoscopy? It is a series of illuminated concentric rings that are projected on the cornea. It uses the corneal tear film as a mirror, and the reflected image of the ring is captured by a digital video camera. The captured image is subjected to computerized algorithms to identify the position of rings relative to the video keratographic axis. And then based on that, we get the angulation, then the radius of curvature, and finally the dioptric K value. So what is the use of colors? All of these maps that we would have seen, they are containing color maps, that is red, green, blue, so on and so forth. So the color maps include red color, that is a hot color, that indicates that that point is a steep K value, that is a steep point or a higher K value. Green and yellow are intermediate K values, normal range, and cool colors such as violet and blue are flat points. This is just a representation. I will be going into more detail about this in further slides. So how do we read a topographic map? We look at the name, date, and eye and confirm that this is the right map of the right patient, of the right eye, of the right date. And what kind of scale has been used? What type of measurement is being displayed, whether it's the height, the curvature, or the power? What is the step interval involved? Whether each color is separated by 0.25 diopters, 0.5 diopters, 1 diopter, so on and so forth. What is the map that is being looked at? The statistical information, that is the K values, the surface regularity index, the asphericity, so on and so forth. And we compare this with previous maps of the same eye to look for followability, and with the topography of the other eye of the same patient. And of course, you should always ensure that the scale involved is the same. So what are the types of scale that are available? The absolute scale or the standard scale. Please remember that this is a machine chosen scale. The machine that we have in our hospital, that is the Atlas operator, takes the minimum value as 38.5 and the maximum value of 49.5. The values between this are divided based on color scale, and then the values are then represented on the cornea. So if you look at this, this is probably a symmetric bow tie where the vertical meridian is steeper than the horizontal meridian, with a steep K value of around 47.5 and a flat K value of 42. What it does, it forces the data to fit within a predetermined dioptric range. So in this case, 49.5 to 38.5. The advantages are, it is a consistent map. It allows direct and rapid comparison between maps of one eye to another because it has been selected by the machine. So it is fixed for that particular machine, and it avoids confusion and is familiar for the user. The second type of map is the normalized scale or the auto scale. This is a particular keratometry map that has been selected based on the keratometric values of the eye. So if you see in the previous case, it was 38.5 minimum value, which has now become 41.5, and the maximum value was 49.5, which has now become 47. These are based on the minimum and maximum, are based on the minimum and maximum of that particular eye. So we see that it looks like it is even more hot color or red color, although it is the same eye represented using a different scale. Since this is individualized for a particular eye, the reproducibility is very low. The third type is the custom scale. So the custom scale can be selected by the operator. So in this case, I chose to select the minimum value as 42. And the maximum value is 53, and all the colors were divided in that range. So now you look at this cornea, you feel that is a very flat cornea. But if you look at the green, you can see that it corresponds to the range, that is 47. So again, the reproducibility is not much with this kind of a scale. Now moving on to the types of maps, as I had previously discussed, there are two types of radius of curvature, the global and the tangential radius of curvature. So what happens here is that at each point of the cornea, a tangent is drawn, and that from that tangent, a line is dropped down to the optical axis. So this Rx, the line from that point to the optical axis in a perpendicular manner, is the radius of curvature for point X. Ry similarly is the radius of curvature for point Y. Now, the problem with this kind of a system is that it is based on a spherical algorithm with a particular axis. And so it assumes that the cornea is spherical. It measures the curvature of each point in an axial direction and describes the overall shape of the cornea. On the other hand, the local or tangential curvature looks at each set of points. Let's say there is a point X. At that point, the machine will draw a circle, and the radius of that circle will be the radius of curvature of point X. At point Y, it will draw another circle, and the radius of curvature of that circle is the radius of curvature for point Y. So for each separate point, it will draw a circle and calculate the radius of curvature of that point, completely independent of any sort of optical axis. Therefore, there is no spherical bias in this particular method, which means that it is able to pick up successfully localized changes. This is very, very important because it is able to pick up small amount of irregularities from one point to the next point to the next point, so on and so forth. So with an axial curvature map, it will give you an overall shape. When I represent the same thing as a tangential curvature map, you can see that the central steepening, vertical steepening is less, and there's much more peripheral flattening that is noted. This is because of the normal shape of the cornea that is steeper in the center and tends to flatten out slowly towards the periphery. This is an absolutely normal representation, but it has occurred because we have changed the curvature to show us localized irregularities in a better manner. So the third type of map is an elevation map. As I have already discussed, elevation data cannot be obtained without incorrect assumptions from a topography machine. So this is an anterior elevation map that we have obtained. There are certain assumptions that have gone into obtaining this data. The major use of this data is in terms of fitting of the RGB contact lenses. This is another type of map called the refractive power map. It does not have much use in clinical practice. However, it is a useful way of representing the refractive effect of the cornea in patients undergoing corneal or refractive surgery. It is the least accurate way of describing corneal shape due to assumptions made during its derivation. Another type of map that is known as the pathfinder. This is specific to the machine that is the Zeiss Atlas topographer. What it does is that the Pathfinder 2 is based on a large multi-center clinical trial study that was conducted, so that where they looked at multiple topography patterns and they decided that these could fit into multiple categories, either a normal topography, keratoconic pattern, post-myopic LASIK, post-hyperopic LASIK, or any other pattern. So we can see that based on the topography that the machine has picked up, it has classified this patient as absolutely normal. Since this is based on a large clinical database, it helps as a screening tool, but as much as possible, it is better to rely on your own topographic information rather than a screening tool. So what are the types of topography maps that can be obtained when we look at a particular map? You can have a round pattern, an oval pattern, superior steepening, inferior steepening, and if no pattern is seen, it's all irregular, it is known as an irregular pattern. You can also have what is known as symmetrical bow tie, like what we have been seeing in the previous slides, a symmetrical bow tie with skewing of the radial axis. So you can see that this is a non-skewed bow tie. If this is bent in this particular direction, as in here, this becomes a skewed bow tie. And this amount of skewing from the axis, as you can see here, if this exceeds 21 degrees, it is called significant skewing of the radial axis. Then there can be an asymmetric bow tie with inferior steepening, where the inferior portion is more steep than the superior portion, an asymmetric bow tie with superior steepening, an asymmetric bow tie with inferior steepening with skewing of the radial axis. This pattern is commonly seen in moderate keratoconus. So this is what a round pattern looks like. If you look at the keratometry values here, they are fairly regular, and this is a round pattern. This is what an oval pattern looks like. This, what we have previously discussed, is a symmetrical bow tie. You can see that both arms of the bow tie are fairly equal. This is an asymmetric bow tie with inferior steepening. This is an asymmetric bow tie with superior steepening. Let us look at some quantitative descriptors now. So what is a simulated K? So simulated K readings are those obtained from the radius values at the central 3mm zone. Remember that the keratometer, the Bausch-Lomb keratometer, also gives you 3mm zone values. So this can be compared to that, although the method is slightly more complex here. So by convention, the major axis will be the one with the greatest power, and the minor axis will be 90 degrees to the major axis. So if you look at this, this is the KS, also known as the steep K, value 55.72 at 44. This is the KF or the flat K, value 54.45 at 134. This is 90 degrees by convention to the K steep. There is a third value that has been given, that is the minimum K. When the entire cornea is being mapped, it is not necessary that the minimum K may be the same as the flat K, because the minimum K is the least value, whereas the flat K is simply by convention at 90 degrees to the steep K. So, which is why you're getting a minimum K at 138, whereas a flat K at 134. Then the other values that are available are the average K, that is the average of KS and KF, the cylinder, that is the difference between KS and KF, the surface regularity index, and the surface asymmetry index that I will just discuss. So what is surface asymmetry index? It is a measure of the difference in corneal powers between points on the same ring 180 degrees apart. So if you look at this, this is an example of a 7 mm ring on the cornea, and this is an example of a 3 mm ring. So the machine will calculate the difference between this point, and that will be one value. And then this point, and that will be another value. And then this point, and that will be a third value. And it will give a summation of all of that and give you a particular value. However, the central values have higher weighting than the peripheral values. The normal value of the surface asymmetry index is less than 0.5. The surface regularity index is a measure of the local regularity of the corneal surface within the central 4.5 mm diameter. That is, within this area, the power of each point is compared with that of the points immediately surrounding it. So if you have point A within the central 4.5 and point B is next to it, there'll be a comparison between A and B, and that will give you one value, and such multiple values are calculated. And then the SRI is calculated, and in a normal cornea, the value should be less than 1. It correlates well with the visual acuity. Asphericity is an index that I personally prefer to look at, and it helps me confirm my diagnosis several times. So it is the value of measure of curvature change from the center to periphery. Remember that the normal cornea is slightly aspheric, which means that the center is steeper as compared to the periphery, which is slightly flatter. A perfect sphere is neither steep nor flat in the center or periphery. It maintains the same curvature throughout. So the asphericity value of a normal cornea is minus 0.26. If you have an ideally perfectly aspheric surface, that is minus 0.52. For a prolate cornea, where the center is even more curved than a normal cornea, for example, in keratoconus, the Q value will tend towards more negativity. In an oblate cornea, where the center is more flat, that is such as post-myopic laser vision correction, the Q value is more positive. This is a very important slide for the residents. Please pay attention to this particular slide. The Rabinowitz criteria is often asked in your examinations. So if you look at a keratometry value of 47.2 or more, if you look at the difference between the inferior and the superior keratometry value of 1.4 diopters or more, and if you look at the KISA percent index, and if that is greater than 100, that's highly suggestive of frank keratoconus. And if it's between 60 and 100%, that represents keratoconus suspects. So keratometry value more than 47.2, inferior superior value more than 1.4, and KISA percent more than 100%. This is Rabinowitz criteria. Now let us look at some abnormal topography maps. This looked like what could have been a fairly normal cornea, but you're seeing a well demarcated, regular, completely flat surface in the middle that is well centered. This is most likely because of a well-centered myopic LASIK. This was a patient of ours who underwent PRK in 2015. You can see that he had an asymmetric bow tie with superior steepening in the right eye and a symmetric bow tie in the left eye. So 6 weeks post PRK, when the topography was repeated, you can see the flattening in both eyes. The flattening in this particular case, who has also undergone myopic LASIK, is displaced superiorly. This is most likely a post-myopic LASIK decentered ablation. This was another patient of ours who had undergone PRK recently. Pre-PRK refractive error in the right eye is minus 6 diopters sphere, and in the left eye minus 3.5 diopters sphere with a minus 1 cylinder. So when we did the PRK for him, he was doing well post-operatively. However, 1 month later, we could see that there was superonasal decentration in the right eye more compared to the left eye. And the postoperative refractive error at 1 month was minus 2.5 diopter sphere with a minus one diopter sphere in the left eye. So we continued his topical steroids. Subsequently, when we repeated the topography after 1 month, the healing response had kicked in, and 2 months postoperatively, you can see that the ablation appears much better centered in the right and the left eye, and he has a residual refractive error of minus 1.5. So if myopic ablation causes a central flattening, then the only way that the central steepening will occur such as this is most likely because of a hyperopic ablation. This is what is known as an irregular pattern. You can see that there are multiple points that were not at all detected by the machine, and the remaining points are showing a very haphazard pattern. In fact, no pattern at all. This was a 66-year-old male for whom we have done a penetrating keratoplasty for bullous keratopathy, and he reported with a BCVA of CF 2 meters at 2 months post-op. Since his fundus was clinically appearing normal, we decided to advise him a rigid gas permeable contact lens trial in the next visit. So when we saw him a month later and repeated the topography, although it is still quite irregular, you can see that there is a steep axis, there is a flat axis. So it was far more regular as compared to the previous topography. And the steep K was 44 and the flat K was 40. So this was not correlating with the BCVA of CF 2 meters. And even though fundus was appearing clinically normal, we decided to do a macular OCT, which showed gross cystoid macular edema, for which we have placed the patient on napafenac eye drops 3 times a day. And since he's a diabetic, we have also injected intravitreal Avastin. So in this case, the topography helped us determine that the cause of loss of vision needed to be further looked into, and it prompted us to do the macular OCT. This was a 31-year-old male who was referred as he was not tolerating any sort of contact lenses. The AR value in the right eye was minus 2.5 diopter sphere with a minus 2.5 diopter cylinder at 15. And in the left eye, he accepted plano with a minus 2.5 diopter cylinder at 150. But he was not accepting the cylindrical power whatsoever. And also in his previous glass prescription, he did not have a cylinder incorporated. So we did the topography, and you can see the significant inferior steepening here. So he was diagnosed to have mild to moderate keratoconus, even though the K values were not very high, but still, this was a case with early to moderate keratoconus. We advised an RGP contact lens trial for him, but he was not keen and he was comfortable with his glasses. So in this case, the topography helped us identify the cause of changing refractive error. And since he's a 31-year-old, that we expect that the keratoconus may not progress beyond this point. So we have advised him 6-monthly follow-up. This was another patient. This is a 36-year-old female who underwent LASIK elsewhere in both eyes 17 years ago. For the past 2 years, she has been reporting gradual progressive diminution of vision with frequent change of glasses. At this current visit, she is wearing a minus 7 diopter sphere in the right eye with a minus 2 diopter cylinder and a minus 9 diopter sphere in the left eye with a minus 3 diopter cylinder. So when we did the topography in August 2019, we could see that there was significant inferior steepening as noted here, with a steep K value of 51 and a flat K value of 49. She was diagnosed as a case of post-LASIK ectasia. She came back recently because she was complaining of mild blurring of vision in the left eye. The right eye topography was again repeated, and you can see that the inferior steepening seems to have increased as compared to the previous visit. You have a steep K that has increased from 51.7 to 52.5 and a flat K that is almost the same. This is what is known as a difference map. It superimposes and calculates the difference between this map and the previous map and tells you the changes that have occurred over the intervening period of time. So you can see that there is a certain amount of steepening that has occurred inferiorly, which corroborates with our diagnosis. This was a case of progressive post-LASIK ectasia. We have advised her collagen cross-linking for the right eye, and she is awaiting the same. This is another patient, a 24-year-old girl with diminution of vision in the right eye. She had a history of corneal opacity since age 9 and underwent corneal transplant 8 months ago for the same. There was no improvement in vision in the postoperative period, and she was suspected to have amblyopia. The right eye had hand movements vision with a small angle exotropia and a normal fundus. You can see the topography, there's significant steepening in this particular area, and the rest of the cornea post the graft is fairly flat with steep K value of 47 and flat K of 34. We felt that there might be sutures at the 150 and the 130 axis that might be tugging and causing steepening in this particular area. So we did a topography guided suture removal for two sutures here. You can see one of the sutures that we have snapped and that retracted back into the cornea. There was another suture right next to it in this particular area that we snapped and removed. And 1 month later, although the topography is still highly irregular, there is significant regularization of the steepening across the midline. The topography values show steep K of 48 and flat K of 43. The difference is 5 as compared to what it was 12 diopters previously. The vision has improved from hand movements to 624 and she is doing well. So this is a typical exam question for the residents. This is an inferior steepening showing a crab claw pattern where the claws are intersecting somewhere in the middle. This is a typical example of pellucid marginal degeneration. Remember that the steepening in pellucid marginal degeneration is predominantly seen inferiorly, but there is another degeneration where the steepening is predominantly seen superiorly, and that is known as Terrien's marginal degeneration. So moving on to the concept of elevation, based on the data obtained during imaging, the machine selects a reference surface that is most commonly a sphere. This needs to be compared to how we measure things in geography, whereas sea level is a reference surface and everything such as, for example, Mount Everest 8,800 meters above sea level. So in the same way, based on the values that we have obtained, a particular machine will calculate a reference surface, and all points that fall below that point are represented with negative value, and all points that fall above that point are represented with a positive value. This data or elevation data is not very well obtained in a correct manner from reflection-based systems. However, there are other systems that can give this data in a reliable fashion, such as the scanning slit systems. The concept of a scanning slit system is that there are 40 single images captured by a high-speed camera that moves from one direction to the other, capturing 20 images, and then another direction and back to the same direction, capturing another 20 images. So in the central area, there is significant overlap that occurs, and this causes higher resolution of the central 3 to 5 mm. Since each slit image contains 240 data points, we get a multiplication of about 9,000 data points on every surface plane. This is the way the scanning slit technology works, and the most commonly used machine based on the scanning slit technology is the OBSCAN 2Z. Remember for the residents again that this is the layout of a normal OBSCAN map. You will see four maps, two on each side, and the statistical data will be represented in the center. So the normally maps that will be given to you are anterior elevation, posterior elevation, pachymetry, and curvature map. However, there is another machine that has superseded the OBSCAN in terms of the reliability and the elevation data, and that is the Scheimpflug system. The Scheimpflug system is based on the concept of photography and the Scheimpflug principle. So any camera or a regular camera has a picture plane, an objective plane, and a film plane. If these three are moved so that they intersect at one point, then what happens is that we get a greater depth of focus. So the Scheimpflug principle states that to get a higher depth of focus, move the three planes, provided that the picture plane, the objective plane, and the film plane have to cut each other in one line or at one point of intersection. So the Scheimpflug systems are based on a rotating camera based on the Scheimpflug principle. They capture topography and pachymetry of anterior and posterior surfaces. Also, anterior chamber analysis, including chamber angle, chamber volume, chamber height. And all of this data is transferred to the machine, which generates a 3D model of the anterior segment. The Pentacam is the most commonly used Scheimpflug system, which is able to collect 25,002 elevation data points as compared to 9,000 with the OBSCAN. So this is a regular Pentacam map. Again, for the residents, please remember that the statistical data will lie in the middle in an OBSCAN map, but in a Pentacam, you will see all the data to the left. Now, I'll just teach you how to describe this map or go through this map a little bit. So first, always look at the patient data. From there, you look at this particular column, that is the QS, also known as the quality scale. It should be okay. If there are data gaps, then the map needs to be repeated. From there, you move to the keratometry, K1 and K2. K2, in this case, is the steep K. We can see that both of these are within the normal range. From here, you can move to the pachymetry data. So the pachy apex is 530, which is in the normal range, and the thinnest local. Thinnest local defines the thinnest point across the entire cornea. So here, the thinnest local is 529, which is also fairly normal. So if you look at this point, that is thinnest local, is this circle is thinnest local, and you look at the elevation here, the elevation, that is the back elevation, is -1. That is completely normal. And then you look at the sagittal curvature map. This is similar to what we have seen in the reflection based systems, and you can see that there is a bow tie here without any skewing and with mild inferior steepening. This is a completely normal topography, pentacam map. On the other hand, this is another map. Again, if you look at the quality score, it is okay. The K values show a steep K2. Anything more than 49 is suspicious. Then you move to the pachymetry of the apex. 448 is less than normal. Thinnest local 443 is also less than normal. Anything less than 470 should raise suspicion. And you look at this value called the K max, 54.3. Again, anything more than 49 here is suspicious. So you look at the thinnest local point, that is this empty circle, and you compare it with the elevation at that point, which is roughly in the range of 34 to 35. For a posterior or back elevation map, the elevation at the thinnest local more than 17 microns instead of 34. So 34 is highly abnormal, but even if it was 17 microns, it would be suggestive of keratoconus. And then you look at the sagittal curvature map, and you can see that it looks like an asymmetric bow tie with skewing of the radial axis. This was most likely a case of keratoconus. The other modalities that include the anterior segment OCT, which uses infrared light and low coherence interferometry to give high resolution images of the cornea along with keratometry, pachymetry, and elevation data. So all of the data that we have previously discussed is also available with the anterior segment OCT, but one additional feature that it gives to study post-LASIK ectasia and keratoconus is epithelial thickness map. Because what happens is, over the cone of a keratoconus, the epithelium undergoes early thinning. This is believed to be one of the earlier signs of keratoconus, and it can be detected with the OCT. To conclude, corneal topography is an essential tool for keratoconic eyes, refractive surgery planning, and eyes with corneal grafts. It gives reliable data of anterior surface curvature and corneal power. However, it is limited by no data of posterior corneal surface, which can only be obtained with OPSCAN, Pentacam, and ASOCT. Thank you.
Hello, sir.
Yes.
Sir, please comment, sir.
Prabhat, well covered. There were some questions. I think we'll just go through some of the questions which have been asked, and then we can just go through some of the points so that it becomes easier. One of the first questions that was asked was in the chat group was on post-COVID, whether there is any way that we want to take precautions when we take these patients up for topography in terms of how do we clean the instruments. So basically, we are still going to be following the same thing. For mask for you, mask for the patient. So that reduces the contact, and the headrest, chin rest, the handles will all be wiped with your bacillocid or your sterilium solution as such. Nothing more is required as such, because ultimately it's the only place where where the patient contacts with the machine is only on the headrest, chin rests, and the handles. So those alone you need to wipe between patients and allow the alcohol to evaporate, so that we've taken care of the bug as such. Apart from that, nothing else that we need to do. And obviously, the patient and the technician would be having probably an N95 mask as such. The next question somebody had asked was with respect to a difference map, whether you need a pupil overlay so that you're able to see where the, sorry, not the difference map, with respect to the decentered ablation, whether you need a pupil overlay. Yes, a pupil overlay would give you a better idea as to how the treatment is centered across the pupil. So that's a good way of understanding it. But the best way also would be on top of a pupil overlay, it would be better to use what we call, what is called as the tangential map rather than the sagittal map. Because the tangential map gives you the subtle difference between the treated area and the untreated area. So it becomes a lot more clear as to what exactly is the treated area, what is the untreated or the transitional zone. So it becomes better. So you can use a pupil overlay and you can use the tangential map. The third thing was in terms of determining skewing. You have the option of putting the axis in overlay on the maps. So you will have these lines which go across the bow tie, which tells you what is the axis of the superior bow tie and what is the axis of the inferior bow tie. So then you can exactly see what the angle it is doing, because if the axis is more than 22 degrees, then it is called as a skewed radial axis and it becomes significant. These were some of the things. Somebody had asked how to practical tips, especially how to apply in daily practice. So basically, Prabhat, can you just put the your first slide with your Atlas topographer?
The first slide, sir.
First slide, yeah. Just a basic TMS photo. Picture, yeah. Next, no, the with the image with your
this one.
No. The your stack for TMS of your Atlas topographer.
This one.
Print out here to go. Print out.
Any print out you give. Sure.
Okay. Just one second, sir. Yeah, this one is fine.
It's not moving. Yeah. Just go. Yeah. So, yeah, the previous one, not the pathfinder. The previous one, just a sagittal or an axial curvature maps.
Yes, sir.
Simple axial curvature map.
Yes, sir.
Everyone, axial curvature. Okay, fine. Yeah, perfect. So, when you're looking at a topographer unit, you need to know what machine you are dealing with. So, if you're dealing with a Plasido-based device, this is probably the printout that you will get most of the time. If you're dealing with images which machines which are going to give you both the anterior curvature and the posterior curvature, then you will have images similar to what Prabhat showed with respect to the pentacam. So we'll come to that part subsequently. So any map that you see, first thing, confirm that it is the same patient, confirm the date that the procedure was done, because if you're going to compare a patient's with respect to keratoconus, you need to know the previous map and this map. That would be the first basic thing. Then you would look at the scale that is being selected. Like Prabhat showed, that if your scale gets changed, then your color coding gets altered. And what seems more red might actually just be the fact that you have changed your color coding. So each machine has a range. So if you look at the Tomy machine from Nikon, we have a value of 0.5 to 110. Some of the machines might have different ranges. So whichever machine is giving you the printout, you need to know the range and you need to know whether the colors have been fitted in that predetermined range or it is fitted with respect to that particular cornea. So in this case, like we said, it is from 38 to 49. Just go to the next image. In this case, the same eye is fitted between 38 to 49. So if you change the range, obviously the color coding changes. And we are all these color codes are actually, they are so visually appealing that you normally tend to look at the color codes rather than looking at these values. And we get used to seeing the reds and the greens and the blues. So preferable to always maintain a standard color coding as far as the first map or the first time that you see the patient is concerned. If you want to look into the map in more detail, then you go on to changing it based on that particular patient. But that is more to read the map more in detail, not as your initial screening of the map as such, so that you are always clear as to what you are looking at. So that is the next thing. Then the third thing would be the curvature. So when you're looking at the curvature, like he showed the show the map with the different types of patterns, Prabhat. The 8-9 types of patterns, axial patterns, yeah. So this, it tells you what are the patterns that you would normally get. Most of the time you have an asymmetric bow tie. Most of the time, most of the maps will be asymmetric bow tie. But if there is significant skewing, then you are concerned. If it is irregular, again, you are concerned. If it is significantly inferior steepening, you are concerned. So there are certain signs which make you more worried that it could probably be keratoconus. So you need to look at those maps, that images in more detail. So this is your shape of your topography that is seen on your axial or your sagittal map as such. So this, as far as your basic go back to the to your printout slide. Apart from this, you have the indices. Back, yeah. So you will have the indices. Most of the machines come with their own software of indices. So you do not need to actually remember the values as far as the TM, the Placido-based system is concerned, because they will normally have a drop-down box below where they will say keratoconus suspect, frank keratoconus or not, like the Pathfinder, which is there in Atlas. Every machine utilizes some of the integrated softwares with various, either with KISA index, with inferior superior steepening, with multiple values to tell you or give you suggestions that this could probably be a keratoconic eye as such. Having said that, you would still need, at this day and age, you would definitely need to know about the posterior elevation values also before you can actually comment on it being keratoconus or not. The other important thing is, unless it's your exams and you have been given a printout and asked to read a printout, never comment on a topography map without seeing the patient. Because if you have a scar and there is a bulge here, the machine is going to interpret it as a keratoconus, because it's an irregular cornea which is beyond what is normally seen, and the machine would give you telltale signs as if it is keratoconus, but it might actually just be because of a corneal scar or some kind of a corneal pathology in that that area. So always, when you are reading a map, before that you need to make sure that there is nothing in the cornea which is corresponding to it, corresponding to the changes that the machine shows, unless it is something with respect to keratoconus, where you can obviously see the signs of keratoconus and your map is confirming it. In your exams, you are given a map and you have to read it based on the parameters. So you would in when you are answering, you would say this would probably be keratoconus. So you would not say, you don't say this is keratoconus, you would use this is probably keratoconus because of, say, inferior steepening, the K values are very high, there is skewing of radial axis which is beyond 22 degrees, so it fits into Rabinowitz criteria and it could be keratoconus. I would like to investigate the patient further to look at corneal thickness, because your Placido based device doesn't give you your corneal thickness. So you would say, I would want to investigate the patient with respect to corneal thickness, and based on the age of the patient, I would decide whether I want to follow up the patient and consider the option of cross linkage. That would be as far as a Placido-based device is concerned. You also have all these values in terms of your keratometric value, steep K, flat K, astigmatism, which are all mentioned, which you can use for your IOL calculations in case you have an irregular cornea or a scarred cornea and you want to do a cataract surgery. Again, when you're doing a cataract surgery and you're using keratometer to calculate your Ks, if you are not able to get a K with keratometer, obviously it's an indication to do a corneal topography. So you at least have some idea about the corneal curvature when you are planning for your IOL calculations. It's not that you take the other eye keratometric values, because the other eye keratometric values might not be the same as this eye, because this has a corneal pathology, either a scar or something which is causing you, which is causing the irregularity, and because of which you're not able to get your keratometer to give you a good reading. So if your keratometer doesn't give you a reading, it is distorted, and you are planning for a cataract surgery, you would get a topographer done. If your topography also is so bad that you're not able to get any value, then you might need to actually consider whether you would want to do a corneal transplant for that patient, because the cornea is so irregular, or you would need to tell the patient that you might have to still use contact lenses on top in spite of you putting an IOL inside the eye, because the irregularity of the cornea cannot be corrected by an intraocular lens alone. So this would be as far as your Placido-based device is concerned. You can just put the Pentacam map. So difference between topography and tomography, basically topography is in terms of only the surface, whereas a tomography is like a computer tomography or a CT scan gives you a slice. So when you're evaluating both the anterior and the internal structure, you are able to get some idea about the inner layer of the cornea, also in terms of its curvature, and you are getting an idea about its thickness. So when we use the word tomography, it is applied to instruments which are able to give you both the anterior cornea as well as the posterior cornea corneal surface information. When we use the word topography, we basically mean only the anterior cornea. But then there is always we generally don't use in a normal routine practice, we continue using the word topography regularly. But if you want to ideally use it, a tomography would be for a scanning slit. It would be for pentacam or shine plug based devices or OCT based devices which have the ability to measure your posterior cornea also. A topography is the this thing for all placido based or a reflection based devices which are only capturing the data from the anterior cornea as such. Scarring will cause thinning. It can cause a thinning, and adjacent to that area or in that same area, scarring can cause an ectasia also, because if it is very thin, the cornea can bulge in that area. What normally happens if it scars, it becomes flatter in that area, and the surrounding area will show a slight steepening. So that when you are looking at only a topography map, it will show it up as an irregular cornea. It might pick it up as an irregular cornea, or it might pick it up as keratoconus based on the density of the scar or the location of the scar and the severity of the distortion. So that is the why when you are reading a topography map in clinical practice, always see the patient in slit lamp and then read the map. So when you're looking at pentacam, Prabhat mentioned it. So again, similarly, you always check the name, date. So you have different, here you have a block. This is with respect to pentacam. So you have other shine plug based devices, like you have the Galilee and you have the Cirrus, which also are based on shine plug camera. Pentacam is based on a single shine plug, rotating shine plug camera. Galilee and Cirrus is based on a dual shine plug camera. Galilee also has an additional Placido's ring. So in that sense, Galilee gives you both a Placido as well as a shine plug image as such. Pentacam, the advantage of Pentacam at this point of time is a lot of these abnormal values are color-coded in Pentacam. So it becomes very easy at the color codes to know that you're dealing with a borderline value or you're dealing with an abnormal value. But primarily, it boils down to the machine that you are being used, you are used to. And once you keep seeing the same maps again and again, you get used to any abnormalities in that cornea. So here in Pentacam, it gives you these blocks on the side, which basically is on the front cornea, the back cornea, the thickness, and the cornea or the anterior chamber values. So when you're looking at, say, an anterior cornea, it gives you your radius of curvature, and it gives you your K steep and K flat. Posterior cornea also, it again gives you the same data. The corneal thickness, this is important because if the thinnest point is significantly decentered from the center, now in this case, you can see that the thinnest point is coinciding with the center. But if this thinnest point goes down, say, by 0.5 or 1 millimeter, then it's not normal, it is abnormal. So decentration of the thinnest point is one of the important factors as far as keratoconus is concerned. Again, when you look at four maps, or this is called as a four quad map. So whenever you get four maps like this, whichever machine it may be, maybe it may be a scanning slit op scan map, or it might be a pentacam or a Cirrus, you would call it as a four quad map, which gives you, you have the drop down menus, which you can select whichever map you want. So you can have a sagittal curvature or an axial curvature, tangent, whatever map you want, a refractive map here. So here it's giving us the sagittal curvature anterior. It's giving us the elevation front, it's giving us the elevation back, and it's giving us the corneal thickness. Most commonly, these are the four maps that come in a four quad map, but you can always change it based on the drop down menu that is there. So you would always look at problems happening in the same area in all the maps. So you look at your thinnest point. If your thinnest point is decentered, and that is coinciding with the steepest area, that is coinciding with the highest elevation which is coming up in the back elevation maps, it's coinciding with the highest elevation that's coming up in the front elevation map. So if you have more than two points which are borderline or abnormal, you would probably label that map as abnormal, and you would want to assess the patient in more detail to rule out keratoconus. Going through the individual indices for pentacam might be a separate class in itself, and I think that can be covered subsequently. But broadly speaking, you need to look, it's not just one parameter that helps you diagnose keratoconus as such. You will need to look at multiple maps and identify the same problem or abnormality in the same area in multiple maps, which gives you the idea that this could be abnormal. Somebody has asked the difference between a Q value and surface asymmetric index. A Q value basically is only the when you look at a spherical surface, the light rays don't fall on the same plane. There is a range at which the light rays fall. So you could have light rays from the periphery actually falling in front of your ideal plane if it is a pure spherical surface. So when we make it aspherical, and an ideal aspherical surface, light rays hitting that surface at any one point will focus only at a single point. So an ideal aspherical surface has a value of minus 0.52. When you talk about asphericity, that is what we are talking about with respect to your central curvature and your peripheral curvature. With respect to SAI, surface asymmetry index, you are looking at two points which are 180 degrees apart and trying to see how symmetrical they are with respect to each other, trying to tell you how regular the surface is across 180 degrees. So if you're looking primarily at a superior, if you're looking at an inferior keratoconus, if you look at the SAI value of, and it averages it out, but of all the 256 odd meridians that it takes the values. So if you look at an SAI superiorly and inferiorly, that quadrant value will actually be much higher. A nasal temporal value will be much, will probably be close to normal. So when it takes all these values together and it averages and gives you a value, an SAI which is high, or an SRI, a surface regularity index which is high, basically indicates an irregular cornea. SRI takes into account more the central cornea. It is basically the central 3 millimeter area, 4 millimeter area, where it takes into account how the power fluctuates between one point to an adjacent point. So since the SRI takes the central cornea into account, it is more representative of your visual potential. So some of the maps, topography maps, might also have something called as PVA at the bottom, which basically means potential visual acuity. So based on the central regularity of your cornea, it will tell you whether your cornea is capable of having 20/60 vision, 20/40 vision, 20/80 vision. So that is based on the surface regularity index. A surface asymmetry index is going to be much higher for a peripheral disease, say like a TMD or a PMD or a sagging keratoconus. You will actually have a much higher SAI. Whereas if you have a central keratoconus, central globular keratoconus, your SAI value might actually be normal. Somebody's asked, is Cirrus topography? Yes, it is a tomography. Cirrus is actually a tomography because it also uses a dual channel plug camera. Somebody wanted to explain the tangential maps. Tangential maps, basically, like Prabhat had said, when you talk of a sagittal map, you assume your cornea is spherical and all the curvature values are with respect to the visual axis. It's in the center of the eye. Whereas when you look at a tangential map, it calculates the curvature of one point with respect to the adjacent point. So it is like if you look at a moon from far, it looks smooth. Whereas if you go closer, you are able to see a lot more deviations. So when your reference is a very broad reference, the minor irregularities get smoothened out. So that's why a sagittal map gives you a more smoother surface. Whereas a tangential map, since it is with respect to adjacent irregularities, any local fluctuations like a post-refractive procedure, the boundary between a treated and an untreated area become a lot more visible in a tangential map as compared to a pure sagittal map. The normal values in elevation map primarily are related to pentacam, but then each machine, whether it is Pentacam, whether it is Cirrus, whether it is Galilee, have their own elevation values, because all of these have their own mathematical models which are inbuilt into it. So it's not that a value of 16 in Pentacam is going to be the same, because even if I take a normal cornea and I measure them with five different machines, not all the values are going to be the same. You will have differences even in the keratometric values as such. So each machine, when you're looking at an elevation, whether it is Pentacam, whether it is Cirrus, whether it is Galilee, has a cutoff which is machine specific. The normalized data with respect to when you're talking about a normalized data in context of a topography map, it is with respect to the machine as to what is the range that the machine is able to calculate. It could be from 30 to 90, or it could be from 50, from 35 to 110, based on what the machine capability is. Shermer's test need not be done before a topography. When you click on the topography map, if your mires are not regular, the rings that you see will be broken. If your rings are broken, then you ask the patient to blink a couple of times and then repeat the picture. If in spite of repeated blinks, you're not getting a good mire, then you can put a lubricating drop and take the image. But then it does indicate that the patient is probably having some amount of dry eye. So if you're going to be utilizing these values for IOL calculation, you need to inform your consultant, and they might need to improve the ocular surface status before cataract surgery is planned. OpScan they have a latest version of OpScan which has come up now, but at this point of time, I think the Scheimpflug based devices are the most valued ones as far as tomography is concerned. But we might soon be probably shifting to OCT based devices, because it can help us get epithelial thickness mapping also, which a Scheimpflug cannot give us. So that's again something which is interesting, because the epithelium keeps changing with respect to, it's a good masking agent. So a lot of areas, the epithelial thickness or thinning or thickening masks irregularities. So understanding the epithelial behavior is also going to be something interesting. And maybe a couple of years down the line, we might be shifting to OCT based devices. How do we utilize, there was a question on displaced apex syndrome, but I think it'd be difficult to speak about it unless we have the map. So maybe the next class, when it's conducted on Pentacam, we can have that particular image, so it becomes easier for you to understand. How do we utilize elevation maps? Basically, when you are looking at an elevation map, you need to look at the central 6 to 8 millimeters of your map and look at what is the elevation value in that. So as far as Pentacam is concerned, a posterior elevation value of more than 16 or 17 is considered to be suspicious. If you look at the posterior elevation value of OpScan, that value comes to close to around 50. If you look at posterior elevation values of Galilee or Cirrus, that's again different. So again, it depends on the reference for each machine. But so if you're looking at this, you're looking at the central area, there is a posterior elevation. You look at the anterior elevation map also, there is a elevation which is high. So the anterior elevation value is around 10, around 8. More than 8 is considered borderline. A posterior elevation value of more than 16, 17 is considered borderline. But again, all these are not independent values. If you look at, if everything is fine and you're getting a posterior elevation value which is high in the center, yes, that is significant. Whereas if you have a posterior elevation value which is borderline, anterior elevation value which is normal, all the others are normal, it could still be a normal patient. So borderline is more with respect to a pre-refractive surgery patient. So if a patient comes with a borderline value, I would probably want to reassess the patient 6 months to a year down the line and then take a definitive call as far as keratorefractive procedure is concerned. Just a minute, I just need to plug in my charger. for a cataract surgeon doing premium IOLs, I would ideally want to look at the posterior cornea in most of these premium IOL patients. So in that sense, I would probably think a tomography unit would be better, whether it is Pentacam, whether it is Galilee, whether it is Cirrus, or it's an OCT with, nowadays you have the OCT from a couple of companies where you have everything, you have the IOL calculation also in it, because it is calculating the axial length also. It's taking your corneal curvature with respect to the OCT. It's giving you your posterior curvature also. So you also have the Pentacam AXL, which is available now in the market, which is a single machine, which gives you most of the data. But again, it depends on the cost. It depends on your volume. It depends on your IOL bundling. All those factors would decide. But I would definitely think if you're doing high volume premium IOLs, then looking at the posterior cornea, especially with respect to toric IOLs, it would be more predictable. Obviously, the Barrett's calculator does put in a fudged value, and you're able to get to a reasonable amount of accuracy even without actually looking at the posterior. All patients who are unhappy, if in your routine practice that has not been a significant number, been say 1 in 100, then you might just continue in the same manner, and for that one patient you might do a surface procedure or something else to top up the refractive surface. But ideally speaking, yes, I would want to look at the posterior cornea.
Sir, you're not audible, sir. Hello?
Hello? Not audible? Hello? Hello? Am I audible?
Yes, sir. Please continue.
So, the question was, which machine will we suggest for cataract surgeons doing premium IOL? I would ideally say that having a machine which gives you an idea about the posterior cornea would be the best way forward. Having said that, you do have the Barrett's universal formula also, which is able to give you a fudge factor, and you're able to get reasonable accuracy even without actually measuring the posterior curvature. But if you're somebody who's really finicky about his refractive outcomes, then yes, looking at the posterior curvature would make a lot more sense. Difference between OPSCAN and PentaCam is the way that the image is captured. With OPSCAN, it uses a slit with a scan, and that is why it gives a different value. A Scheimpflug based image has a different principle in which it captures the image. Is for doing an AutoK, is there a cutoff that will indicate topography? There is no, I mean, obviously, if you are having a value of 48, 49, which has come in your AutoK, you would want to get a topography. But otherwise, there's no cutoff. When you're doing a manual, you always look at the Myers. If your Myers are irregular or distorted, then you would want to go ahead with the topography. And if you examine the patient in slit lamp and you feel there's something abnormal, then you would want to do a topography. Your refraction, when somebody is doing it and sees some amount of splitting of reflex, you would want to get a topography. Toric IOL for keratoconus patient depends on the it depends on a case to case basis. Your topography has to be reasonably regular. You need to know it is keratoconus and it is not pellucid marginal degeneration, because PMD can even worsen later in life. Keratoconus would generally stabilize, but there are reports of keratoconus progressing even after 45-50 years of age. So if you're sure that the K is not changing, and your topography is reasonably regular, and the patient